G'day, it's Rowan from Ferguson Brothers Rail. In this video, we're going to look how to get your DCC locos running for under $100 or about 50 or 60 US, building your own command station with Arduino. Now this video assumes you already know your way around a soldering iron, but if you've always been curious about Arduino and never dip your toes in, then I'm going to go through step by step how I did this with an Android phone and a PC. It's quite easy and I'm going to include all the costs as well. This video has got two parts. The first part is me building a basic little bridge over my program track. That's because I wanted to test out some deep pour resin before I go and drop it on the layout. If you're here mostly just for the DCC information, then feel free to skip ahead to about 9 minutes. Let's go.
All right, I'm starting with XPS foam, which runs the length of my program track. I'll glue this onto a bit of lumber, so there's plenty of strength when I carve out for the river. The length is 920mm to fit a couple lengths of N-scale code 55. One section of track for DCC programming and the other for testing. I'm using a 4-pin microphone socket I had in the parts box. Four terminals will connect to my rails, and it means I can separate the track from the electronics and power supply for easy storage. The cavity for this has to go in before I glue my XPS to the timber base. I'm using sculpt mold to cover the foam, then some grout to give it texture. I'm not trying to win any awards for realism here, it's really just an excuse to test my deep pour resin. I'm building up the detail, thinking about how water would move through, and adding some sticks for submerged logs. After that dries, I airbrush the submerged elements before adding a green wash over everything. All I want are murky shapes under the semi-opaque water. I'm using a low exothermic resin product I purchased here in Australia, which is sold mostly for application in furniture. Add a little bit of brown pigment, so I don't want the water to be completely clear. Using a jewellery scale to measure by weight ensures accuracy, then I transfer to another container after stirring to ensure the final pour doesn't have any unmixed solution that may have been trapped in the size of a plastic cup. Bubbles are easy to blow away through a corking gun tip. I had some perspex lying around that I used to dam the sides. A lesson learned here though, I didn't apply a release agent, which made the perspex quite hard to remove. 10 minutes later, after some grinding with the flap disc and some sanding down to a 2000 grit, the surface is clean and smooth. Next thing I did was prepare the tracks with some brown paint. I was planning to weather and ballast the tracks, but later decided it was a bit of a waste, given this is only a programming track. I soldered in the drop feeds and glued the track down with a mixture of Mod Podge matte, water, and a little bit of extra PVC for strength. Using an old milk bottle, I traced through to make a template for the fascia board. The fascia board was made from some scraps of 3mm MDF. Then I later painted it with some old grey house paint. I brushed some gloss lacquer over the resin sides and corners, which adds instant visibility into the murky water. I'm mostly happy with the results, although next time I'd back off on the brown pigment. A tiny bit goes a long way, and I'd prefer the water to be just a little bit more transparent than it is. It doesn't show up well on the camera, but you can see into the water if you look from a close distance. Building your own command station with Arduino is a great way to get into DCC if you're not quite ready to purchase an expensive proprietary system. There's a few options for configuring the build, and I'm going to go for as simple as possible. I'm going with a knockoff Mega 2560, an L298P motor shield, and not a Chinese Wi-Fi shield. After buying the Chinese Wi-Fi card, I discovered it required modification to use. I ended up going with a Makerfabs ESP8266 for my Wi-Fi card, which I had to get shipped over from the US. They come in the mail stuck to a bit of foam, so often the pins need straightening out a bit first. Here I'm scratching out the VIN trace on the motor shield. Why? We want to feed our railroad 12 volts, which is too much for the Arduino Mega. So by cutting the power between them, we can supply the track with 12 volts and the Mega with 9 volts. There's another option for isolating the cards, which I'll show later. Now we can carefully join the motor shield onto the Mega by starting on one side and gently easing all the pins in. Cards are cut like an arrow shape, which helps you align them in the right direction. Also check the pin markings. For example, A0 to A5 should line up on all three cards. The DCC guys recommend a 12 volt 3 amp DC power source for the motor shield, which would be plenty to run a few locos concurrently. I had a plug in my parts box, and as I mentioned earlier, this allows me to disconnect the electronics component completely from the program track. This isn't necessary, I just like to keep things tidy so I don't have things hanging together with wires. I always check plug connections with the multimeter. Let's have a closer look at the MotorShield power terminal block. Bottom two for power in, noting the order for positive and negative polarity. Up from that is the power to the main track, test track, and then at the top is the program track. Later when you use each of these tracks, you'll see the lights light up on the board. Here's my 9 volt 1 amp DC power supply for the Mega board. And here's an important tip. Some of these power supplies come with center pin negative, as mine did. You can find this standardized marking on the unit. The Arduino is expecting positive polarity for the center pin. This didn't bother me as I wanted to shorten the lead anyway, so when I soldered it back together, I simply reversed the wires. Here I've already joined the Makerfabs card onto the motor shield, just to line and seat the pins as before. It comes with a couple of jumpers that you'll need to remove with some pliers. Next we need to connect the Wi-Fi card to our Mega using the transfer and receive pins. I only have jumper leads with male pins at each end, so I had to solder them onto the Wi-Fi pins. I'm using the 7th pins right on the end, so they're easier to get to with the soldering iron. These solders are ugly because my camera was in the way. I'll actually clean them up a bit later. Just remember, transfer to receive and receive to transfer. So from the Mega, you connect transfer, which is TX18, to the receive, and also from the Mega, you connect the receive pin, which is we're using RX19, to the transfer on the Wi-Fi board. Got it? Okay, now just screwing in the leads for my track. I've labeled the program track wires with back, just so I didn't get them mixed up. Remember I mentioned there's two options for isolating the power from the Mega to the motor shield? Let's take a look at that now. Some people prefer this option because it's easy to put back if you change your mind. You take the VIN pin on the motor shield and carefully bend it outwards. Then when you seat the cards together, this pin hangs out the side, not making an electrical connection. Time to plug this in and test the connections. Okay, that's good, we've got lights. I'll connect to the track to test, but first we have to program this Mega. You can download the source code and configure it manually, or you can use an automated installer from a DCC EX website. This detects your operating system and guides you through the process. For this video, I'm going to use the automated installer so we can get through this in the easiest way possible. The installer will download a zip, which you need to extract. On Windows, I simply click Extract All, then navigate to the destination where it extracted the files. Now, connect your Mega to your PC using the USB cable that shipped with your card. Double-click the EX installer EXE file, and you should see a black box appear, followed by the user interface, which offers you some input fields. I want to build Command Station EX, and I select the options in Board Type and Motor Shield, which reflects the cards I've got. Leave the LCD and OLED checkboxes unchecked, as you won't need these by using the free engine driver software. To COM port, I select COM4, Arduino Mega, and then I move over to the Network tab. The Network tab reflects the hostname and server port you should see appear in your Wi-Fi settings later. On the Wi-Fi tab, make sure you select Enable Wi-Fi. Then you go back to the first tab and hit the Compile and Upload button. It'll take a minute or two to compile and you'll see the progress bar move along the bottom. Once it's finished, you want to see the Uploaded Successfully over in the Output window to the right-hand side. You might want to go ahead and test your command station right away. I'm going to install the Arduino development environment so I can test the setup and check for network details. With the Mega still connected to my PC, I check the port first to COM4, then I open the serial monitor. This does a few checks and I can see the network name and password that I need to enter to connect this network from my mobile phone. Okay, I'm done here now. After recording the password, I can unplug the Mega from my PC and head back to the program track. On my Android phone, I head over to Google Play and download the engine driver, which is free. Jump onto the Wi-Fi settings, and you should see your DCC EX card appear as an available network. When I select this for the first time, I have to enter the password I highlighted in the Arduino serial monitor. When you first open engine driver, it steps you through a few settings to customize your user interface. Then you should see your DCC EX network with port number, which you can tap to select. When your network has moved up to discovered servers, you're ready to connect a loco. From the main control screen, I can run two locos at once. To select a loco, tap select, and you can enter a loco address or request a loco ID while it's still on your program track. Make sure you've powered up, then you can test your loco. Here I'm demonstrating running two locos independently on the same track. My son had fun playing with this loco, which has a sound decoder built into it. Look, I'm no expert with this stuff, but I managed to get it working without too much drama. There's a good support network you can access through the DCC EX website, so I'd start there if you run into trouble. Generally speaking, when I decide to do something, I do a heap of research, then often just put a few ideas together. My channel is really just a way of capturing some of those insights and passing them forward onto others. If you like what I'm doing, consider supporting me by subscribing to the channel. I only put out videos every 2 or 3 months, so if you hit the notification bell, I promise you won't get too bothered by my channel. Thanks for visiting, and I hope to see you soon.